What's good? It's your boy, Mixtape Moth, and today I'm going to hit y'all with a classic review of Mike Geronimo's The Natural from 1995. Let's get to it. Mike Geronimo's debut album, The Natural, turned 25 years old on November 28th of this year. Today, I wanted to highlight this album because it's a very strong East Coast project that rarely gets mentioned when we talk about classic rap albums from 1995. With all the big name New York rap releases of that year, this album unfortunately got swept under the rug. Now, Mike Geronimo was an MC coming out of Flushing, Queens. He was bringing listeners that smooth but gritty Wastelands flavor. It was definitely a Queens thing, his style of rhyming to the way he carried himself. At this particular time, Mike Geronimo was poised to be one of the next biggest stars in New York rap, but he was on a label called Blunt Records, so unfortunately he didn't receive the commercial exposure necessary to do so. But let's get right into this album. It's 13 tracks, lasting just short of an hour at 59 minutes. Let's take a look at this album cover. I always dug this cover a lot as it gave you a glimpse into where he was coming from. If I recall correctly, this picture was shot in Royal Flush's hood, but regardless, it was a gritty cover that felt very New York. If you were from the South or Midwest, you could get an idea of what things looked like in Queens, at least after dark, that is. When we look at the production, Mike Geronimo had 4 beats from Mark Sparks, 3 from Buck Wild of DITC, 3 from Irv Gotti, who went by DJ Irv at that time, 2 from the Beat Miners of Boot Camp Click fame, and 1 from the late Shy Skills of the Onyx Production Camp. As far as the features went, you had Royal Flush on a lot of these songs. He appeared 7 times. Now, this was before Royal Flush made songs like Worldwide and Moving On Your Weak Production. The rap world just knew him at the time as Mike Geronimo's homie. I'll talk about the other features in the track-by-track breakdown, but let's just jump right into these tracks. The opener, The Natural, was a single produced by Mark Sparks. It had an atmospheric yet bouncy beat. There were scratches from Big Daddy Kane, This Is For Your Own Concern. Mike Geronimo was just floating on this beat effortlessly. Leave those unprofessional pros alone. Enjoy the sound that's now emitting out the microphone. Every word personified, create astonishing lines. Go inside and pull a paragraph or two from my mind. Those were top-notch bars. I kind of got Rakim vibes from this. It was a very dope single and opening song for this album. He lets you know out the gate why he was a natural at this rap shit. Track 2 was Life Check, produced by the Beat Miners. I always thought this particular beat just personified the sound of New York boom bap in 1995. It was a textbook, mid-tempo, rugged, and head-bobbing type of beat. The dense drums went super hard. 1-1-2-2-2. Now, I suppose this beat sounded like a leftover from Smith & Wesson's The Shining, but I still love this track regardless. Up next was the Mark Sparks produced single, Wherever You Are. This was actually the 3rd single from the album. It got some radio play in 1996. This was a classy and feel-good radio single, but it had strong and smooth lyricism throughout. It was a laid-back kind of anthem with a catchy enough chorus. I had no complaints. Track 4, Master IC, produced by Buck Wild, was an underground gem. This record got a lot of play on the mixtape scene. It's definitely a top 10 Buck Wild beat, in my opinion. The sound was smooth and melodic, but also murky and a little mysterious. It was a total vibe. I love when a xylophone is used in hip hop. Royal Flush's chorus was basic but memorable as ever. I'm so high, you so high. I'll be getting money till the day that I die. Mike G opened with, Behold the uncontrollable. I keep the whole world in drama. Smoke my competition out, they just a bag of skama. And it's been a long time, maybe too long, since your audio produced a real rap song. Bars like these just showed why he was a natural and master technician on the mic. Right after was Man of My Own, featuring Royal Flush on the hook again. Flush could say the simplest hook, but his raspy voice made it appealing. This song was produced by Chai Skills. There was a prominent horn riff throughout. It's Wasn't one of my favorite beats, but it was still solid. It definitely captured that gritty essence for sure. And I could also appreciate Mike G's content about hustling and coming of age. Then we had Time to Build, produced by DJ Irv. Now this track is very historic because of who was featured on it. We had three rappers who would, within a couple years, go on to run commercial New York rap. But they weren't that famous at the time. Jay-Z, DMX, and Ja Rule. Well, Jay-Z was the most well-known, but he had not come into his own yet. Gotta say, I love the Rakim It's Time to Build sample. This was a very hard-hitting and up-tempo record. It reminded me of a couple of tracks from Big L's debut album, like a cross between 8 Is Enough and Da Graveyard. If you remember, both were also posse cuts. 8 Is Enough introduced Cameron, while Da Graveyard featured Jay-Z. Jay was rhyming like Dos Effects and the Fushnikas at this time, so Nas's jab on Ether was pretty accurate. I thought DMX sounded like Onyx here. Ja Rule really had the same kind of flow as he would later use. What followed was Shit's Real, produced by DJ Irv. This was the single from 1994 that put the spotlight on Mike Geronimo. This samples the well-known Denise Williams Free, a sample used by quite a few artists in the 90s. The Twins and Lords of the Underground are two that instantly come to mind. This had a dope call and response chorus. I thought this was how a commercial single was supposed to sound. His raps were cool, confident, but gutter. He kind of gave me some LL Cool J meets Nas vibes on this track, you know, as far as his lyrical swag was concerned. Right after was Three Stories High, produced by Buckwild. It was another underground gem. There was what sounded like dripping water on this beat. Again, it was very murky and blunted sounding, almost as if it was recorded in a dingy basement. To me, this track just matched the grittiness of high-rise tenement buildings. I love the back and forth between Royal Flush and Mike Geronimo. This was the first song where we got an actual Royal Flush verse. Mike G had a line where he reflected on his man getting wet up over a blend tape. Now that's some wild shit. Also, Royal Flush being an authentic street dude in real life brought that streetwise energy to this record. After this was Shireen, a storytelling track produced by Mark Sparks. I always got a Q-Tip vibe from the jazzy production, especially from the drums, which sounded like they belonged on the infamous album. Mike G tells the tale of a shiesty girl who was scheming, so I guess this could be looked at as a cautionary tale. What we have next was the underrated posse cut Men vs. Many, featuring OC, Royal Flush, and CeeLo. No, not CeeLo from Goody Mob. This crunchy and space-like boom bap beat was produced by the Beat Miners. It was a fire instrumental, in my opinion, the perfect style of beat for a posse cut. This track was the epitome of MCs catching wreck over a dope instrumental. You had some ill back and forth between OC, Royal Flush, and Mike G. This was another song that got a lot of love on mixtapes and in the underground scene. Track 11 was Train of Thought, produced by Buckwild. This was one of the darker and grimier beats on the album. This song just puts you in that killer Queens and the infamous state of mind. Mike G let y'all know that he's coming from the planet of Queens, motherfucker. Flush again on the hook, adding to the suspenseful and eerie feel of the record. This track was raw like Subway Graffiti in the 80s. The following song, Things Change, was more of a down-tempo record. The beat provided by Mark Sparks was soulful and mellow. There was even an R&B chorus, which I actually liked, although a lot of people consider this to be the weakest song on the album. It did feature Mike Geronimo and Royal Flush in more of a contemplative and introspective light. The album ended with the remix to Master IC. This was more of a commercialized and up-tempo version of the original. It had an early Bad Boy Records flavor to it, in my opinion, from the knocking guitar lick to the female R&B vocals. It just seemed more geared for the radio. You had the Lost Boys also coming out of Queens and Royal Flush appearing for the final time on the album. I liked the funky groove and how they all made it a Queens affair. It was a night and day difference from the original, but I still liked it. So there you have it, The Natural, 25 years later. The replay value is still strong. It is an underrated street classic and an underrated New York hip hop album. It is a shame that due to label politics and industry beef, Mike Geronimo lost his footing in the game. He dropped Vendetta 2 years later in 1997. While it had its fair share of dope songs, the project really wasn't that well received. After that album, he kind of faded into obscurity. I think his falling out with Irv Gotti had a lot to do with this, unfortunately. But let me know in the comment section below your thoughts on The Natural. How did it impact you? What were some of your favorite tracks from it? And what should I check out next? It's your boy, Mixtape Moff. I'm signing out, but be sure to hit that like button and please subscribe. As always, it's peace and blessings. Mike Geronimo, The Natural, one.